Hi everyone. My name is Dr. Don Buford. I'm an orthopedic surgeon based in Dallas, Texas, and I'm very appreciative of the opportunity to participate once again in this fantastic meeting. Special thank you to my friends Ignacio Dallo and Pedro Bernaldez for the invitation to participate. I have promised my friend Ignacio, who was just out in Phoenix with us, that if invited, I will definitely come to Sevilla next year for the meeting. So this first talk is titled "Platelet Dosing for Knee and Shoulder: Current Best Practices," and we're going to try and come to some conclusions about dosing for osteoarthritis in the knee and also for rotator cuff tendinopathy based on the current best papers in the literature. These are my disclosures on our American Academy website. This is the handout. The easiest way to get here, if you don't have the QR code, is just to go to any web browser and type in buford.info/2024 Sevilla dose. And so let's start talking about platelet-rich plasma dosing. So it's really more than just the dose. That's the first thing, right? It's leukocyte content, it's injection volume, platelet concentration. The injection schedule, is it once a week? Is it one time a week for 3 weeks in a row? The injection location, is it intra-articular? Is it subacromial? Is it intratendinous? There's so many different variables, and we have to be able to assess all of these so that we can answer the question of K debo acid. This paper, published in 2021 by Rossi, is one of the best papers out there looking at platelet-rich plasma for rotator cuff tendinopathy. This was a level two prospective study. 50 patients were in each group. They did get MRI scans to document the status of the rotator cuff and to confirm that there were no full thickness tears. They do a very nice job quantifying the PRP. They drew 30 cc's of blood. They used a two-spin system to create a leukocyte-rich PRP, although it wasn't very leukocyte-rich. The white blood cell count was 11.2. Most important thing they told us at this point was that the platelet dose was 5 billion per PRP injection. And what they show is really most of us would agree is a very good outcome. 94% of their patients showed a decrease in pain, improvement in functional outcomes as measured by the American Shoulder and Elbow and Constant score. Those improvements happened by 6 months. In addition, 84% of their patients returned to sports by 3 months, and only 7% required a second injection. So here's an example where if we just treat people with a single injection at this dose, we don't need to really schedule people for a second injection unless they really don't do well from the first injection. So I do not typically schedule people for more than one injection. We do one injection and see how they do. In fact, our current protocol at Texas Orthobiologics is on this slide right here. We are currently drawing significantly more blood. We're drawing 120 cc's of blood instead of just 30 cc's, so four times more blood. From that, we're making 12 cc's of leukocyte neutral or leukocyte poor PRP. That allows us to inject three locations on a single day. We place about 5 cc's into the glenohumeral joint from a posterior approach. That's ultrasound guided. We place 1 to 2 cc's intratendinous into the supraspinatus tendon. Again, ultrasound guided. And then we place the final 5 to 6 cc's in the subacromial space, which is the part of our protocol that matches what Rossi reported on. So by doing more locations, our thought process is we can treat the joint. We can also hopefully stimulate a healing response intratendinous as well. This is the dose response curve looking at Rossi's results based on a dose of 5 billion. He reported what I think most of us would assume was a pretty good result, if not excellent result. Time will tell if our modified protocol will give a better result. So let's talk about the knee. There are two level one papers published that are excellent protocols for knee arthritis. The first paper was published by Himanshu Bansal in 2021. He and his co-authors documented a PRP dose of 10 billion platelets in 8 cc's, and the comparison group was a hyaluronic acid injection. There were 75 patients in each group. This was done on a 60 cc blood draw. And what Dr. Bansal documented was that the group that had a single injection of 10 billion platelets had improved WOMAC scores, improved walking distance, and decreased pain scores, and these results were durable out to 1 year. He did look at MRI changes and found that in neither group was there a significant change in cartilage volume. He did also note that the group that had the hyaluronic acid injections had returned to pre-treatment levels in terms of function and pain by 3 months, as opposed to the PRP-treated group, which again had the single injection of 10 billion platelets. Well, their improvements were still above the minimal clinically important difference at 12 months. And so now here's the second paper. That's a level one paper published last year, so 2022 now, by Dr. Chu and his colleagues. This was a very large paper with over 300 patients in each group. Notice the protocol difference compared to Bonsall's study. These patients in the PRP group got three injections once a week, and the other group got sham saline injections once a week for 3 weeks. The blood draw volume was 50 cc's for the PRP group. The PRP was made in a two-spin system. The dose is the key. The dose here was 4.2 billion platelets in 5 cc's. And so that's markedly less than the dose reported in Bonsall's study. Overall, the dose is more because they gave three injections. So the total dose in this study is 12 billion platelets given over 3 weeks. The results were excellent. The PRP group had improved outcomes at every time point from 3 months all the way out to 4 years. In addition, Dr. Chu was able to show that by MRI scan, the group that was treated with PRP had 50% less cartilage loss at 5 years compared to the normal saline group. So this was a brilliant demonstration of disease modification using this PRP protocol for knee osteoarthritis. And so this raises the question of maybe Bonsall's dose at 10 billion in a single injection is too high, and maybe the better protocol, at least as Chu shows, is 4 billion 3 times in a row. So what's the take-home message? Well, I always draw a minimum of 60 cc's of blood because at an average human platelet count, that means we're starting with 12 billion platelets. That usually means that we can inject a PRP dose somewhere between 4 and 10 billion, kind of getting into the range documented by Chu and Bonsall. I'm currently giving a single injection of PRP at the higher dose, so I'm most closely mimicking Bonsall's results, although I would love to now do the study looking at higher dose PRP, so a 10 billion dose, giving it once a week for 3 weeks. So use Bonsall's dose and choose injection protocol and see if that result doesn't get us even farther to the right on the dose response curve. Time will tell. So final thoughts. I think all of us need to continue to hone our evaluation skills and looking at the literature. We need to decide what to do, and then we need to track our outcomes since there's no clear consensus for these two conditions anyway. So I happen to use the registry listed here. There are many registries available. I love that they make it easy to store data and to evaluate data and to communicate with our colleagues across the world. So thank you for your attention. I look forward to sharing my next talk with you shortly and then getting to Sevilla next year. Bye-bye.